We're joined by State District Service Officer Joe DeVito. But as the State District Service Officer, Joe DeVito is a busy guy, so we understand sometimes that schedule can get in the way of things. So, Joe, we're happy to get this program on the air today.
Thanks, man. I'm happy to be here, and I appreciate you accommodating my last-minute schedule change last week.
Certainly. As we always say, we appreciate the opportunity to chat with you, get in touch with your office, and talk about what's available for area veterans.
Absolutely. Our change in schedule this week is a good segue and a reminder to folks that we have 92 counties in the state of Indiana, and every county has a county veteran service officer. That person is there to help the community of veterans and their dependents navigate VA and state benefits, help them apply and understand how they work, how they qualify, where they do and don't, and also help them put those applications in and kind of work with them through the entire process. It's an expert for any veterans to have locally, right, located right near their courthouse, someone to help them with those benefits. And part of the Indiana Department of Veterans Affairs, who oversees the county's service officers' training and education. One of the things they've done is created my job, the district service officer. So we all live in our districts, and we're there to kind of train and support those service officers. And in Clark County, Indiana, down in Jeffersonville, we just had a new service officer hired. So that was the schedule thing, and that's one of our district jobs. One of our main focuses is to go on site and train those new county service officers right there in their office, in their space with their veterans, and as soon as they're hired, which is a really great model. It gets them up to speed fast, it gives them support right there, and it helps be as seamless as possible for the veterans in that community when we have a changeover in a CVSO. So,
and we talk about it all the time, how there's a bunch of different services and benefits available for these veterans. So it's important to have a good person in that office so that they have that resource available.
It really is. You can go on the Indiana Department of Veterans Affairs website, which is in.gov/DVA. You can go on va.gov, and that's the federal benefits. And that's a great starting point for folks to just kind of see how many benefits are out there and all the different types of benefits that are out there. But when it comes to that individual veteran or that dependent of a veteran, really the best thing they can do to learn out what's good for them is to go see your county veteran service officer. They're the expert, they're local, they're right there to help you out specifically for you as an individual, what you can apply for, and they can help you out through that process. So, you know, the goal is we want to get all those county service officers full-time, available for their veterans at all times, and we're working real hard to keep them trained and make that resource as rich as it can be for those veterans.
Like we said, it's a valuable resource for our veterans, a lot of different programs available. One of the things that you wanted to hit on with this month's edition of the show is the different support programs that are available for our veterans.
Absolutely. You know, there's been a lot of focus lately with veterans' mental health and other issues like that, and we want to make sure that folks know that there are resources out there for them, veterans and their families. So there's a few things I'm going to focus with some local stuff, local to our area, that I want to let people know is out there. And I was going to start off talking about our vet center. The VA has created vet centers all over. I think there's close to 300 of them. I'm going to peek at my notes here, around the country. And we have one right here in Louisville, would be the one servicing our area. It's downtown. I think it's on 3rd Street. And it's a really great spot, and it's a really great setup for what the VA has done. Originally, the vet centers were, I think, in the late 70s is when they were kind of put into place and thought up, and they were for Vietnam veterans who were having trouble adjusting, coming back from Vietnam, combat veterans adjusting to coming home. So it was kind of set up for those guys and the precursors with PTSD and other issues that they would have. And then starting with the Gulf War in 1990, then in 91, the Congress kind of, and VA opened up the vet centers to the point where we're at now, where they're open to any veteran from World War II to now who is not only involved in any wartime, but any conflict at all. I know, like Lebanon, Grenada, Panama, if a veteran was serving during any kind of a conflict and had any sort of exposure to something in service that is now giving them an issue, this vet center is there for them. We've talked in the past about VA healthcare. We have the hospitals and the outpatient clinics. Most of the outpatient clinics have mental health places where you can see counselors, psychiatrists, different folks like that. And kind of the unique thing about the vet center is it's a great starting point for any veterans who are having some adjustment issues. And those they can get services at the vet center. The difference really between the vet center and the VA medical centers is that the vet centers are 100% confidential, even to VA. So if a veteran is enrolled in VA healthcare and they may be using their primary care clinic for physical issues and maybe even mental health issues, if a veteran goes to the vet center to reach out for help, it's up to the veteran to give the vet center permission to even share with VA healthcare. So it's a confidential space for a veteran to go meet with their peers, all of the employees at all the vet centers, everyone who works there, they're also veterans. So they have someone they can talk to and kind of get moving toward the right, you know, the right space. They can they work with all the VA medical centers. If the veteran wants to do that kind of thing, they can provide some employment counseling and guidance for with their spouses. They can do benefits referrals, getting them to their county service officers and other folks. They just do a lot of different things there. But it's a, if a veteran feels like he doesn't have, you know, he wants confidentiality, he wants to talk to someone who understands and knows where he's at, it's a great starting point. So it's, and that's our vet center. And that, ours is in Louisville, and the address down there is it's on 1347 South 3rd Street, and that's in Louisville. And their phone number is 502-287-6710. And a quick reminder to everybody out there in our local listening area, every county has a veteran service officer, and this is one of those resources that that service officer can help point them in that direction. So anything you hear about on the program today, if you didn't get a chance to write something down, you want to know a contact, a phone number, an address, you can always give Faith Weir. She's the Jefferson County Veteran Service Officer. You can give her a call, 812-265-3600. She's down on 315 Jefferson Street, and that's a great resource to get any of the information you hear today, as well as check into your benefits.
I think a big thing with programs like that that you're talking about that is really important is that they are, they're veteran run, they're veteran staffed. So you are going into an organization with a lot of people that are very familiar with where you're at the time.
Yeah, absolutely. Most active duty veterans, they, you know, the pleasure I had of being a county service officer for many years here and then in doing my job is, there's a camaraderie amongst veterans. They give each other a lot of guff about things for the different branches, but there's a camaraderie amongst veterans, and there's a underlying trust in some ways. So it is important to know that. And it's important to point out too that part of the Indiana code that kind of oversees the practice of the counties putting our county service officers in place is that all the veteran county service officers are veterans. So all your county service officers are active duty veterans, and they have a minimum active duty requirement, honorable discharge, and some other requirements there. So that's another one of those veteran to veteran situations.
Another one that is available out there is the Family Support Center.
That's right. You know, the VA is doing all they can to kind of approach veterans and help them from all their different aspects that they can. And we were talking about the vet center, which was a little, it's still separate. It's not really part of VA healthcare. It's more of a spot where veterans can go confidentially and understand some of the things that are available and seek some assistance. And along those lines, you know, a lot of veterans have families. They come home, whether they're married or other family situations, and even friends and people who are part of their local and family group. If a veteran has some issues, whether it's post-traumatic stress or just some anxiety or some of the many other issues that folks in these, especially in the combat situations when they come home, that affects a veteran, but it also affects all the people around them. And it's important to not only provide education to those people so they can help understand some of that, but even to support them as well. So the VA has some other programs. through their VA hospitals, and those are the family support centers. I got some information here. The information I have here is out of Rattlebush, which is the Indianapolis VA Medical Center. I'm pretty sure we got some reach with Louisville as well, but you know, Indianapolis is for the state of Indiana, where the one is located there. And the family support center is basically there to help provide counseling for veterans and their family members, and that's either individually and then or together as a group to kind of help understand what it's like for the veterans and how the families can support them, and also so veterans can understand how their actions are affecting their family. So they can help with communication, having empathy in both directions for each other, and understanding that emotional connection in the family and how it's affected by what they went through while they were in the military. I know one of the things that they offer there is they have couples counseling, they have family counseling, and one of the things they have is called a Warrior to Soulmate workshop. And this is something that they'll do with a veteran and whoever the veteran identifies as their partner in any way, shape, or form. I don't think you need to specifically be married or anything like that. If a veteran has a significant other in their life, then that's somebody that they can kind of do the workshop with. And they do this, I know they do a specific type of counseling for them, and it's they can go to these workshops. I know they have them during the weeks, they have them on the weekends, and they also have retreats that I know that are out there as well. So for family members also to know that there is support for them as well. Family members can reach out, the veteran can reach out. So, you know, we have programs in place through VA healthcare, through the vet centers, to kind of help our veterans transition and understand what they're going through as far as some of the symptoms that they go through. I know a lot of the things for anyone out there who's listening, I do know when we talk about counseling or issues that veterans can go through, it doesn't need to feel or seem catastrophic to a veteran. Very small things are a reason enough to go and maybe go see someone and start to understand what those things are. Sometimes that can help before they manifest and get bigger. Sometimes it can just help put them in the right direction as far as understanding that they are affected from their military service in some way. And like I said, it doesn't need to be a huge issue. So even just anxiety, if they notice they have a little bit of trust issues with other folks, they feel depressed, or sometimes they may have really enjoyed certain activities, fishing or bowling or whatever they did, and after they come home, they're not into those things that they'd always had been into as much. They don't have as much interest in it. If they're having some sleep issues, kind of noticing or getting pointed out to from friends and family, they have a little bit short temper, and they're, you know, they feel a little odd in crowds, things like that. Those symptoms from the most mildest to the most severe are flags for them to go and reach out. VA's programs are only set up to help those veterans out, so reaching out is a great thing to do if they feel any of that kind of stress. And if family members are seeing that, and the veteran may not, they can point that out, or they can reach out and through the family support centers and stuff to kind of try and help assistance for those veterans.
I think that's what's really cool about that is, like, we know that sometimes veterans are going through a tremendous struggle. The families are affected by that just as much and a lot of times as well. So having that resource available for not only the veteran but for their family members is a really valuable service as well.
Yeah, it sure is. And, you know, a lot of the times, if a veteran is having some of these issues and they're at home, they can really identify a lot more if in a counseling situation or they realize how much it's affecting their family member, if they kind of find out, maybe not from the family member, but from other folks. So there's lots of things out there, lots of resources to help, and we just want to make sure that veterans know. You know, you can reach out to your county service officer, and they have this literature, they have these things, and they can kind of move you into the right direction as fast as possible. Living the life
I love. I love my life and protecting the environment. So I do what I can, like getting e-statements from my bank instead of all that paper every month, I get a clear, accurate statement online. I'm saving a tree with my e-statement.
Farmers Bank of Milton, your community bank, member FDIC. Visit us online at fbmilton.com.
96.7 FM, WORX. Hello, and thank you for tuning back into Veterans Talk, brought to you by Farmers Bank of Milton. We definitely appreciate Farmers for sponsoring this program, our chance to check in each month with State District Service Officer Joe DeVito, talk about some of the issues and programs that are available for our area veterans. For this month's program, Joe, we've been chatting about a couple different support programs that are available for our veterans, talked about the Vet Center, talked about the Family Support Center. Like you said, those aren't directly affiliated with the VA, but they're still valuable resources that are
absolutely
being provided.
And they are actually VA.
The next one we're talking about
correct
is not directly VA.
Absolutely. We'll recap for a second that the Vet Center are veteran-run centers. They're usually in a home, in a neighborhood, a very comfortable feel for veterans where they can go and kind of with full confidentiality go see some other veterans who are trained counselors and folks who can kind of get them moving in some programs, introduce them to some VA healthcare programs, VA mental health programs that are available to help veterans. Any veteran who did see any sort of a combat service, and they are going to be automatically eligible for VA healthcare. All they have to do is enroll. So there are some other barriers and eligibility factors to get into VA healthcare, but there's a list of a few things that if your service reflected this, you will get in, and that's one of those things. So to be able to get into VA healthcare and get into VA mental health services is not going to be difficult for any veteran coming back who saw any sort of combat operations, whether it was wartime or not. So that's one thing they can look at. And if they're a little nervous about going right into VA healthcare, the Vet Center is a great place to start. It's a great place for resources. They may not want to go the VA full, going into the medical centers and all those routes, but they can stop in the Vet Center for Employment Services and get a good direction of where to go. And those are the Vet Centers. And then we talked about the Family Support Center. And I know the one I was discussing, I got some information from up in Rowdebush. I do know that the information on family support is readily available. If anybody contacts any VA medical center in the country, if they ask for the chaplain's office, that's their route into the family program. So that's where the direct information for what would fit where they live and those things. So we want to make sure that they know where to get a hold of those. And I was going to kind of roll into now a little bit of the stuff that is going on with the Indiana Department of Veterans Affairs. And we've talked about VA healthcare, the Vet Centers, the Family Support Centers, which are all connected to federal VA in some way or another. And there's also really wonderful opportunities for veterans to kind of talk with each other without that clinical feel at all, and that would be peer support groups. Peer support groups are basically it's a scheduled meeting where veterans can get together with each other. Usually there's not a facilitator or a counselor involved. It's literally just veterans kind of hanging out, having some coffee and discussing and talking about how they feel, bouncing off of each other with experiences, where they can kind of feel like they've got that bond with other veterans and that trust, and they can talk about all sorts of issues. And those peer groups are, available to them, and we can help get them set up on those. With Indiana Department of Veterans Affairs, one of my colleagues, state service officers, his name is Lauren Minix. He works up out of the Indianapolis office, but he actually puts more drive time in than any of us district folks. He's on the road all the time, and he covers the state, basically. And one of the main things Lauren does is he helps develop these peer support groups in the community. So if anybody thinks that's a good idea, they want to kind of start it, but you're not sure where to go, you can contact Mr. Minix. He'll come here. He'll come and meet with 1, 2, 3, 10 veterans who are thinking about it, even if there's just one or two who want to start one. He can come. He can give them a structure. He can help them pick venues. He can help them pick topics and ideas. other things to have and how to set it up, and then kind of let them kind of move on by themselves. He can come back and support. There's a lot of support there for them, so it's a great resource for anybody who you think you might want to start a peer group where you guys kind of get together and just chat about things. It could be specific for Vietnam veterans or Iraq veterans, or it could be specific or less specific for any veteran. So you can kind of help develop that. But I wanted to let people know that, that Lauren is out there. His phone number up in Indianapolis is 317-232-3910. And his cell phone number is 317-995-1023. Let me double check that real fast.
Certainly.
1023. That's correct. I've got my reading glasses now. I've hit that spot. So Lauren's a great resource, and if you need to get a hold of him, once again, maybe you don't have a pen or paper. I know I'm throwing numbers and stuff out there. You can call your county veteran service officer, and they can put you right in that spot. Locally here, Jefferson County, Faith Weir is our county veteran service office. You can reach her at 812-265-3600. She's right down in the courthouse annex, right by the courthouse. So we have those groups as well. And like I said, those are just those are veteran to veteran peer support, no VA, no IDVA, as loosely or no affiliated as the group wants to be. So, you know, those are multiple levels where we can kind of, we got the peer support group where veterans are just kind of talking to each other. We got the vet centers that are run by veterans and have VA affiliation but are very confidential. Then we have VA mental health services, which is right into the VA, which can provide all sorts of great counseling for veterans on all levels. And then we have the family support centers as well that can help out for family members, help that whole communication for veterans and family members. So there is support out there. We just want folks to know that you can get that support. And the county, you're going to see your county service officers is the best way to kind of get all that information and get going in the right direction. I do want to throw out real fast as well, since we've been talking about all these issues, that there is also a veterans crisis line available. So if a veteran is at the extreme end of any of these feelings, if they are feeling lost, really depressed, they might think they're harming themselves, harming family members, or just feeling really, really down, there is a veterans crisis line out there that they can call, and it will be answered. It is 1-800-273-8255, and then there'll be a prompt that if they're a veteran to press 1, and they press 1, and they will speak to someone who is trained to speak to them as a veteran. And that's a crisis line that's available for crisis. So I want to make sure folks know, for whatever wherever they're at, there is someone they can reach out to.
They're definitely tremendous programs and services that are available for our veterans. And Joe, we appreciate you coming on and talking about them.